Major funding for the production of Making Sense New England has been made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. The Investor Protection Trust, partnering with Vermont's Banking, Insurance, Securities, and Healthcare Administration, and empowering investors to build and safeguard their futures. The Foundation for Financial Planning, a nonprofit organization helping people take control of their financial lives through financial literacy education and the pro bono outreach of the financial planning community. The FINRA Investor Education Foundation, helping investors ask questions and check investments before they invest. Online at saveandinvest.org. And by Goodwill, helping to stretch budgets since 1933. Online at goodwillnne.org.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Rooks, and this is Making Sense New England. Welcome to Making Sense New England, a monthly series about the economy and you. We are here to share ideas, advice, and solutions to the economic challenges facing all of us. The stories come from neighborhoods throughout northern New England and take on some of the problems caused by the recession. Today, are you considering a timeshare?
Salespeople may say, oh, this is standard language, you know, quick, you don't need to worry about that. You do need to worry about that.
Financial harmony after matrimony.
We're making the right decisions now, but we didn't at one time. Individually, we didn't at one time.
And advice for the older worker.
At any opportunity, you should be in a position to be able to sell yourself. You know, who are you and what can you bring to any particular company?
First, as foreclosure rates in New England climb, so too are the number of people victimized by mortgage fraud. One popular scam involves loan modification. That's when homeowners ask a lender to alter the terms of their mortgage so they can keep paying it. In many cases, credible lenders make loan modification work. But as Making Sense correspondent Phil Vaughn found out, there are plenty of desperate people who are vulnerable to scammers.
Valerie Shea sells homes in North Conway, New Hampshire.
This was all broken, so we replaced all the tile.
Times used to be good, but that changed in 2008.
I was going from, you figure, $40,000 to $60,000 a year to $11,000 that year. That's bad. And then all the bedrooms were done too.
Now with a glut of homes on the market, she does what she can to make a living.
I've been renovating with my husband since 2005, part-time.
Just down the street from this home sits another.
We actually put a shower out there too for the pool. Put a shower there. I have tons of morning glories right
this
now.
This one, however, is her family's. It's being foreclosed on and they're moving out.
How does it feel to come back here?
It hurts.
Shea moved to New Hampshire from New Jersey in 1995.
We downsized. We had enough money to just, play around, get a few jobs here and there.
And for a while, she and her husband, Richard, lived mortgage-free.
TV was there. Sound system was everywhere. I owned this house cash.
Then they started taking out loans against the house. Their debt piled up.
So I started with a small equity, and then out it went. Just got out of control. I decided to go back to college, spent $40,000 on education, the house. My other son, private school, the house. And it just, it goes quick. Just like that, it added up. And then it turned into a mortgage, and then it turned into a nightmare.
That nightmare began when real estate sales plunged and Shea's husband lost his job. With a mortgage of $260,000 and paying 10.5% interest, the Shea's applied for loan modification.
I said, we gotta get a modification, try to get him down to even 7%. We could do a 7. We were at 10.5 a long time.
The lender, Home Eck, denied the application.
I contacted Home Eck and begged them to let me talk to somebody, and they wouldn't. They said, you don't qualify.
Why?
They would never tell me why. They said, no. No, you don't qualify. Wouldn't even give me the paperwork.
Shea saw an ad on TV for home relief services.
So there it popped up. Home relief services, please call us. And I did.
Home relief services?
Yes, Home Relief Services, LLC.
And what are they?
That's the loan modification service counselors.
Home Relief Services asked for an advance fee, which in many states is illegal.
So initially you had sent almost $1,700?
Yeah, $1,695. Huge red flag.
Okay.
K Karen Gorham is New Hampshire's assistant attorney general. She investigates mortgage fraud. Cases like Shay's, she says, are on the rise. A third party, often from out of state, offers to contact lenders and negotiate loan modifications.
Oftentimes they don't do any work. They'll take the money up front and they don't do any work. They'll never contact the lender and they'll be out of business by the time the money back guarantee period kicks in. So the homeowner will never see their money again.
What were they going to provide for that money?
They were going to talk to the lender because I was not able to. Exclusive right.
Shay says her lender was never contacted by Home Relief Services.
You know, I mean, they have to perform almost immediately and they did not. They moved their offices and I don't know where. They just said they opened in another area because they had not paid their rent in
but
the other.
They were in California?
Yeah, in the Laguna Hill area. January 09, they were served with a cease and desist not to practice loan modification.
How much of the money did you get back?
Nothing.
One of the partners in Home Relief Services, Christopher Diener, was arrested in 2009. Shay is just one of his many alleged victims.
He's alleged to have stolen over $1.5 million from various homeowners who were in distress.
It's just that I was so frightened to be thrown. My biggest thing was being thrown on the street and having a lock put outside.
But in the end, that's exactly what happened.
Because it just was a domino ripple effect.
Valerie is a real estate agent. Are you surprised that she was victimized?
No, I'm not. Because, as I mentioned, loan modification scam artists target a vulnerable population. And they say all the right things to get the money from their victim. When someone is in fear of losing their home and they've got a family and they don't know where they're going to go, they believe what they want to believe.
A lot of it's my own fault for being naive. Like I said, I should have known better. I mean, my customers in real estate, I am so good with them. They get the treatment, contracts are perfect, everything's perfect. And then for myself, I just made mistakes.
And what can people like Valerie do to protect themselves?
First of all, never pay an advance fee for a loan modification. If someone asks you for an advance fee, contact the banking department, contact the Consumer Protection Bureau of the Attorney General's office, and ask the questions. Get advice before you pay the money. Don't believe the promises.
What did you learn from this experience?
I learned you can't trust anyone. You have to contact the state for everything.
For Making Sense New England, I'm Phil Vaughn.
If you're considering modifying your mortgage, get advice first. You'll find a list of resources on our website, makingsenseny.org. It may not be very romantic to think of it this way, but any marriage is really a financial partnership, one that consists of an ongoing series of financial decisions, big ones, like whether to buy a house, and small ones, like whether to put that latte on your credit card. Experts say it is really important, especially in tough economic times, that marriages start off and stay on strong financial footing.
So let's take a look at the current temperatures. We have a couple places that have made it to the 90s 3 days in a row.
Kelly LeBrec is a television meteorologist. Aaron Twombly, a television videographer. Both are accomplished young professionals who just happen to be getting married to each other.
What would be good with it? Spicy brown mustard?
They already own a house together. And unlike many young couples, they have a financial plan.
Kelly's really good at making budgets, and I've said it before, but we set up where we budget, we have a house budget, and we have a checking account for the house budget. And we each pay period, money comes out of both of our checks and goes into the house budget. We also save. We also have a house savings account that each paycheck, money goes into the house savings account. And then whatever's left is
play money.
Is your play money.
All that, plus they have been socking away cash in a money market account.
I feel like a little bit of a safety net. I mean, you never know right now. I don't feel like anybody's necessarily safe, but if we need money, where at least it's there.
Yeah. I think you find that, like, we started with just a little bit of money each pay period. Mm-hmm. And we've, like, you know, we're putting in six times that amount now, and we haven't gotten any raises because of the economy. We haven't had a raise a couple of years. But you just sort of manage a little bit at a time to live without that $25. Yeah. And pretty soon it's a couple hundred dollars.
Financial counselor Susan Velagor would approve. She says every couple, young or old, needs to save. She has other advice too. The biggest, talk about money and talk about your attitudes about money.
It's best if they're about to get or they're planning to get married that then they can have the conversations about money prior to finding out that there's differences.
She says those differences are often deeply rooted.
What sorts of behaviors they're demonstrating now around their money can almost be explained by what their history is and what they learned around their parents when they were growing up and what their first messages were that they received.
For me, I have a lot of both my mom and my dad in me. I mean, my dad's a workaholic, so now I'm working two jobs. Like, I enjoy working, and I work hard for my money. And my mom, I have her shopping habits, so.
Experts say two big causes of conflict for married couples are if one person is a spender and the other is a saver, and if one person has a financial secret, for example, a big credit card debt. Susan Velagor sees those potential conflicts as opportunities for compromise and understanding.
And if you really love that person and they're keeping their secret or they have kept a secret, then and now they're revealing it to you, it means they're ready to become open about that and honest. And so there's an opportunity to enhance your relationship.
And we still both have debt, and that's probably the big secret. That secret came out also when we went to get approved for the house. Like, I didn't realize his debt. He didn't know my debt. So it was kind of just out in the open, and now it's turned into probably something we don't really talk about because that's kind of like your own separate thing to take care of. For me, that's still something, it's a lot of guilt for me. I mean, it's hard to try and get rid of it.
We're making the right decisions now. But we didn't at one time. Individually, we didn't at one time before we met.
So as they get closer to the big day, do Aaron and Kelly have any advice for others?
Get married to Kelly because she's very organized.
And I'm good at getting deals.
She is too.
Given that Kelly is already taken, here are Susan Velagor's final thoughts.
It's really about crafting a plan together and being, you know, respectful of one another's histories and not blaming, but just saying, here we are today, and we want to make the best plan that we can, and we're going to honor our pasts and come from a place of love.
For more finance tips for married people, go to our website, makingsenseany.org.
The recession has sent the leisure industry into a tailspin, making certain types of vacation property more affordable. It is at times like these that financial hazard can too easily be mistaken for financial opportunity. Making Sense New England correspondent Bridget Berry Caswell looked into a tried but not always true way to own a share of the great American vacation.
Even in the best of economic times, affording a second home can be a daunting financial proposition. So for many, today's economic climate has made the dream of owning a vacation home nothing more than a fantasy. Unless, of course, you're willing to share your deed with 51 others. Prior to the 1970s, you either owned your own vacation home or rented someone else's. Then an Indiana couple came up with the novel idea of shared ownership, an entrepreneurial invention that some believe was rooted in good intentions.
The timeshare concept was created to be a more efficient allocation of resources. Far more people can afford a vacation of a quality that if they had to own the whole facility, they could never afford.
The majority of timeshare developers still offer clustered condominium-style accommodations as well as recreational amenities such as swimming pools, fitness facilities, and in some cases, even on-site shops and restaurants. But for many potential buyers, it's the prospect of exchanging the fixed one-week use of their unit for the same week at someone else's resort. In theory, a modest additional fee allows you access to scores of other timeshare properties across the nation and even the world. That is, as long as the distant owner is interested in your unit during the one specific week that you own. Timeshare ownership comes with two principal costs. The first is an initial purchase price that can go anywhere from $1 at online auction to more than $20,000 depending on the point of sale and attractiveness of your time interval. And then there's the annual maintenance fee of anywhere from hundreds to thousands of dollars. A fee that's only fixed in the first year of ownership then increases at the discretion of management. Like most well-intentioned business creations, less than scrupulous players have long exploited the public's fascination and gullibility toward timeshares.
There were some high-pressure boiler office sales programs going on. There are a lot of unsophisticated people out there, and unfortunately, there's usually someone to take advantage of them.
The storied Von Trapp family operates one of Vermont's earliest timeshare ventures. Though their interval ownership program is one of the more exemplary, the industry as a whole is beset with image problems.
You have the good and the bad, all within the same industry. The non-desirable ones have one thing in common. We've got you, you're not getting away, we want your money.
When we look at a credit report, Lori, we're looking for a financial story.
As a professional financial advisor, Joe Hicks is the last timeshare owner you'd expect to be taken in by one of the industry's darker realities.
There's no exit strategy in owning a timeshare that does not work for you. I would like out of this, and they're saying, you're not able to get out. My plan was that during the winter months, we could take the family up once a week and go swimming, have a good time there. And we went up there once. And my wife felt it was too far, too much trouble, and we never went again. And I would call them up and say, what do I do? This isn't working for me. I cannot afford it right now. Can I just give this timeshare back to you that I purchased? And they said, no, we don't want it. And I said, well, what does that tell me about the value of it if the resort that sold it doesn't care to have it returned to them even free?
Unable to extract himself from his unused one-week timeshare and a contract whose small print wouldn't let him go, Hicks paid some $7,000 in maintenance fees over 12 years. And when he looked into so-called timeshare resale brokers,
they want $2,000 or $3,000 up front to even list it. And then they give you this inflated price that they tell you that they can sell it for, which is entirely inaccurate.
Consumers are misled into investing more money and losing more money and not obtaining what the result is that they went for.
Misrepresentation, especially during the initial marketing phase of a sale, has long haunted the timeshare business. It's a problem that has disgruntled owners and regulators scrambling to identify infractions.
Timeshare selling is of course legal. What we look at the Attorney General's office is the vehicle by which the consumer is invited to come and view the timeshare. It's the marketing vehicle that we see a lot of complaints around. They come in a number of different forms. Sometimes they're an offer of a vacation package. Sometimes they're types of vouchers. And it's in those marketing disclosures that we really pay attention.
Ultimately, the responsibility for avoiding timeshare investment fraud lies with consumers, and it all begins with reading and understanding the fine print.
They really need to take their time and make sure they understand exactly what each clause of the small print of the contract means. And they should not be shy to request a full explanation from the salespeople. Salespeople may say, oh, this is standard language, you don't need to worry about that. You do need to worry about that.
And take it from those who've been there, the very first thing you should do before embarking on a timeshare shopping expedition is to take a moment to simply reflect.
Timeshare is not a real estate investment. It's a consumer good. It's a purchase. It's a vacation.
And as a vacation plan, it can work very well. But when you believe it to be an investment or an appreciating asset, you're due for a rude awakening.
If you're considering buying into a particular vacation timeshare property, look into its reputation and management policies. And if exchanging your unit for a distant one is important, make sure you've chosen a week that is a desirable one. Most importantly, pay careful attention to the fine print before signing on the dotted line. For Making Sense New England, I'm Bridget Berry Caswell.
You can access more timeshare buying guidelines and fraud avoidance tips, as well as information about where to go if you think you have been victimized by disreputable timeshare sales practices. Just visit our website, makingsenseny.org. As increasing numbers of older workers put off retiring or re-enter the workforce, they often compete for jobs with much younger candidates. Deborah Russell from the National AARP office has advice on how older workers can stay competitive and employed. I understand there are more older workers now searching for a new job. What kind of strategies do you tell older workers they need to employ in this day and age?
Well, first of all, the job search process has changed significantly. For a lot of older workers who may have found themselves for the first time unemployed in, say, the 20 years or so, a lot of has changed. Employers, for instance, predominantly put their jobs online. So there's no more really looking in the newspaper for a job. Posting your job, your resume online is something new as well. Many employers are looking for keywords. So if your resume doesn't have the same keywords that are in the job announcement, they're scanning a lot of those resumes. If that information isn't in there, it's getting kicked out. I think in the past, where you sort of looked in the newspaper for jobs that matched your skills and then you applied and had some success, a lot of that has changed. Now it's really important to do your homework. You need to know, what the labor market is like in your community. What kind of jobs are available? Do you have the skills that match the jobs that are in your community? And if not, how are you going to make sure that you get those skills so that you can get those jobs? So a lot more research is involved in looking for jobs these days.
If you're unemployed and looking for a job, or if you are in a position but looking for another position, how do you brand yourself these days? I understand that's a really important concept for job seekers of all ages today.
Absolutely. I think it's probably a more alien concept for older people than it is for younger people. And mostly because, we grew up in an environment where we were always told we were to be seen, not heard, that the idea of promoting yourself was like bragging. Mm-hmm. So this concept of branding yourself and being able to, what we call, have an elevator speech, where at any opportunity, this really is very tied to networking, at any opportunity, you should be in a position to be able to sell yourself. Who are you and what can you bring to any particular company? And you should be able to have that sort of roll off of your tongue, because in networking, it's all about, how many people that you touch that may know someone else that may be able to get you what you want or you may need.
Do you advise for people to actually stand in front of the mirror and practice that elevator speech and talk with friends and say, can I try this on you? How do I come across?
Absolutely. I think that for a lot of people, you don't necessarily know how you come across until you go into and look into a mirror, or have somebody like a friend give you that kind of objective feedback. And in an environment where you've been in, on 5, 10, 15, 20 interviews, it's hard to stay upbeat and it's hard to stay enthusiastic when you're going on that interview. Branding yourself in an elevator speech sort of helps keep you focused on, really, at the end of the day, what is it that you can bring to an employer.
Are there industries or companies that are better suited for the older workforce and some that are not so well suited? Or do you believe that an older workforce can be competitive and productive in every industry out there?
Well, let's remember, when we talk about an older workforce, certainly with AARP, those are people that are 50 and over. So, certainly there are plenty of older workers that are competitive, that are upbeat, that are enthusiastic, and most importantly, have the skills that employers are looking for. I think that the bigger challenge is just the confidence that is needed in order to do the work. So are there certain industries that lend themselves to older workers? Certainly. And those are industries that are right now in need of workers. So healthcare is a great example of that, where there are just simply not enough healthcare workers, not even just nurses, but home healthcare workers, physician assistants, even pharmacists that are in that industry. So that industry is actively recruiting older workers, both who may have retired that they can bring back into the workforce, or even looking at retention strategies that can keep workers in the workplace. And there are other industries that are following suit as well. Certainly retail and even the service industry, customer service, where they know that their workforce needs to reflect the population that they're trying to or the consumers that they're trying to serve.
All right. Well, Deborah Russell, thank you so much for taking the time to join us for Making Sense New England.
My pleasure.
Remember to visit makingsenseny.org for information, resources, and tips related to Northern New England's economy. I'm Jennifer Rooks. Thanks for being part of Making Sense New England.
Anytime somebody guarantees that they will get you a loan modification or claim that they have a 99% success rate in working with the lender, or promise that you'll get your money back if the loan modification is not successful, all of those are signs that it's a scam operation, because nobody can make that kind of a promise. Nobody knows what the lender is going to do with the loan. They will guarantee a particular interest rate reduction or a particular principal reduction or a certain payment in the future, and that simply can't be done. The homeowner can work directly with their lender to attempt a loan modification.
Major funding for the production of Making Sense New England has been made possible by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting, the Investor Protection Trust, partnering with Vermont's Banking, Insurance, Securities, and Healthcare Administration, and empowering investors to build and safeguard their futures. The Foundation for Financial Planning, a nonprofit organization helping people take control of their financial lives through financial literacy education and the pro bono outreach of the financial planning community. The FINRA Investor Education Foundation, helping investors ask questions and check investments before they invest. Online at saveandinvest.org. And by Goodwill, helping to stretch budgets since 1933. Online at goodwillnne.org.